5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. They would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to noticing its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sure.
Deal.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeffy. Let's start the show.
When Woody and I were at Beachfoot, we ran into Tammy Murray. She does a show with Richter. It's called After Hours with Richter. She's the co-host of it. And she makes these glass pendants. They look like Bigfoots, and they're on a little necklace. And I remember I've seen them a long time ago. It's a sweet, sassy, glassy. And Woody and I got our pendants when we were there, and I actually think they're kind of cool. Mine's a jet black one. Woody got kind of a, what's it, like a charger blue?
Yeah, it's kind of a cobalt blue, I guess. You know, kind of a outline of a Bigfoot. But not only does she make that, she makes a whole bunch of other stuff, too. You know, certain glass cuttings that she personally makes, pressing of glass. She presses metal into glass. It's anything you want, anything that looks cool, she has it. You gotta check her out. Good stuff.
Yeah, we'll have to get you one of these things, Will. They're actually pretty cool. It looks like a little Bigfoot. It's like a piece of glass that's cut out that looks like Bigfoot.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, they're really cool, actually. The word on the street, she's naming the black one after me. That's just what I heard.
There's a story behind that, Wes? Maybe something we can't hear.
It was a long weekend, Will. It was a long weekend.
It wasn't that long.
I'll pursue it no further. Fingers in my ears going la, 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 la.
Yeah, la, 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 la. I hear nothing. I hear nothing.
I see nothing.
I see nothing.
Yeah. Worst promotion of someone's product ever.
Yeah. We'll be getting text messages shortly after the show's aired, I'm sure. Cammy's going to rip her
out. Is there a certain letter rating after this that we're supposed to know about? Or?
I'd like to formally apologize to the After Hours crew and staff.
Yes.
We also went up to the Browns, and that was pretty awesome, too.
That was a lot of fun. You know, I wasn't feeling so hot, Wes, but I do have a lot of pictures and stuff yet to post. I haven't really talked to John or Sarah since then, but I'm sure it's okay with them, you know, if I post them, but I kind of want to get the okay. But a lot of the stuff we saw out there was kind of weird, don't you think? I mean, there was a lot of things that kind of make you go, you know what I mean?
Yeah, a lot, and a lot of vocals. I mean, it was nonstop vocals when we got there, nonstop vocals almost throughout the night till about 1 in the morning. But
it even started before it got dark. Yeah, it was even before it was dark. And then we heard, you know, 3, 4, 5 things. And then, it was a really cool, really cool adventure. Will, we got to get you out there. You'd love it. You go crazy.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You go crazy, man. There's a lot of stuff that probably you'd see that I didn't even see. But Yeah, like I said, I'm gonna go ahead and throw some of that stuff up on Facebook. I've got some of the stuff that I think Wes, you saw that they tied the fence. There was tying of fences together. There was some looked like some hand toys that were made, branches being twisted, and there was a whole bunch of stuff. You could see where they were maybe getting cool during the day. You know, more to come. I'll post those up on Facebook as soon as I get a chance. I just haven't been feeling good, man. I felt like crap these last few days, so I apologize.
Have you guys seen this? Megan Fox is wanting to be taken out on an expedition.
I saw something on it, yeah.
Woody knows who Megan Fox is.
Well, in my personal email a few weeks back, yeah, she actually did say something to me about that.
Yeah, right.
Is this something like the Bigfoot thing we were, you know, we need to maybe not know about, or?
Oh no, I think everybody should know about it. You know, I think everybody should know. The rumor is, yes, Wes, she's actively interested in Bigfoot, and probably if she had the right opportunity and the right time, she'd probably jump at the chance to go do it. I don't know that whole lot about her, but.
Yeah, it'd be cool to take someone like Megan Fox out. But God, can you imagine if like paparazzi show up, or God, that would drive me nuts. Something like that happened. It almost like you'd want to keep it quiet just so something like that doesn't happen.
I know a few months back we had, I'm not sure if it was me or you, but one of us sent an email via Twitter. I think I sent her a message sometime back. Of course, no response, like most women with me. Yeah, I did send her a Twitter message, and I think we've tried contact her since then, but yet to find out if she's interested or not.
You know who else I heard was really into Bigfoot was Nicolas Cage. I heard he's like a super Bigfoot freak. He'd be kind of cool to take out. Not as good as Megan Fox, but, you know.
I think it'd be great, man. He's a cool guy. I've seen some, you know, he definitely is interested. I've seen some interviews with him, and he's not afraid to come out and say that he is interested. So I think that's kind of cool, being in the celebrity scene, to kind of step out of your box and let everybody know that, you know, hey, yeah, possibly he believes in Bigfoot. I'm not sure. Has he had a sighting, or is he just interested? Do you know?
I don't think so. I think he's just interested.
Yeah, he's just kind of checking it out. So, yeah, cool guy. That'd be another cool guy to go without, you know, in the celebrity field. That'd be fun.
Yeah. You should start stalking him the way you do Megan Fox. Maybe we'll get a response back.
No stalking. There's no stalking going on. Come on, guy.
First person I wanted to bring on tonight was Shannon LeGros. And she's been into Bigfoot for a while. She sent us some messages. She follows the show, but she does a lot, looks like a lot out there in the field. She recently went to the Salt Fork, and stayed, and I was looking at pictures online. Looks like she got some footprints, and she was talking about different sounds or different vocals that they had while they're out there. But I wanted to go ahead and welcome Shannon to the show.
Hey there. How are you guys?
Doing pretty good. Doing pretty good.
Doing good.
We were hoping you'd give us an update. What's going on I saw some of the footprints that you had taken while out there at the Salt Fork State Park.
If it's anything, they looked older. It looked like an older, print of something. I wasn't definitely insinuating it was Bigfoot, but it was interesting. That was right next to our campsite, though. So that was a cool find. The toe, well, the quote-unquote toe area, is what grabbed my attention. We had hiked so much that I probably found 20 different things I could have been like, oh, it looks like a footprint, but that was the only one I was like, well, there could be some toe impressions there, and there's a heel mark. So I took the snap. I guess it wouldn't hurt to at least document it and put it in the file, you know?
Yeah, no, it was good. So tell us, when you were out there, what did you see? What did you hear?
So I went out there because they've been having some reports out at the primitive site. Now, the primitive site is actually named Bigfoot Ridge because there is so many sightings out there. There's no lighting. There's no electricity that runs out there. So, you know, if you're going to go camp and looking for Bigfoot, I suppose that's the way to go. And now we camped right next to a site that a couple had an encounter last year, which actually got them fleeing their camp early, like in the middle of the night. So we camped next to their site, and I happened to see an older gentleman pull in by himself, and he starts unloading his gear. We go over and we say hello. We go, oh, what are you doing out here? And he goes, oh, I'm doing work. And he said, okay, well, have a nice day. We'll talk to you later. And I thought it was a little odd, and I thought, well, I'll just talk to him because I bet he's a Bigfooter. Sure enough, I start chatting with him, and he says, I say, so what kind of work do you do? And he goes, oh, I'm studying wildlife migration patterns. And I go, Bigfoot? He goes, yeah. So he was kind of stoked about that. When you think about the VFRO or any of the other reporting sites, that's just what's reported. This guy had a sighting 2 months ago, and that's why he was out there. Walk down to where his sighting is, and it's right behind our campsite. So he had the whole tree peak experience, and he said, I didn't know they were there until they wanted me to know they were there, because they didn't hear a stick break until the two creatures were about 25 feet from them, and this is about 2 in the morning. But then he said once they saw him and knew that he had seen them, they took off. That stuck with him, and he admitted that, you know, they frightened him, but he had to get back on the horse because he loved the subject enough. So we ended up going after dark with him to the same site, and this is just a groomed service road for the park service out there, and we just sat on the ground. We weren't doing any hauls or wood knocks or anything. We just kind of were sitting there chatting, you know, acting like we weren't Bigfooting. And I can't, just like the cast or the track, I can't say it was Bigfoot, but we hadn't heard a peep for a long time. Not a bird, not a cricket, nothing. And I was standing, just checking things out, listening. We weren't even talking at this point, and heard a loud monotone whistle. But it sounded odd, and it freaked me out because it sounded like a bad mimic of a bird. And it was very loud, and it wasn't in the tree. It was probably barely a stone's throw in front of us in the brush. So it freaked me out. So I went from standing to crouching real quick.
I bet.
Yeah. That got me. So I thought, well, I've kind of heard a lot about mimics and whatnot. Again, I can't say it was a Bigfoot, you know, messing with Sasquatch kind of thing. But it was interesting, you know, to say the least.
It never hurts to take pictures of things and document it.
Yeah.
Because down the road somewhere, it might connect to something you find bigger.
Yeah, that's what I thought about the track. Because it did end at an interesting point, because where that track was pointing was right to our campsite, and it was right behind a big bush. So I thought, well, that's interesting.
And Shannon, you had something run through your camp, didn't you?
Yes. The first two nights, it was just before dawn. It was loud enough to wake me up. Me being who I am, and as much as I love the subject, I had Bigfoot on the brain. But there was footsteps because it woke me up. They weren't heavy. And so the best way I can describe it is somebody was, yeah, they were trying to not step hard, but you could still hear it going through very slowly. They went from one side to the other, and then it sounded like it was extremely close to the front of the tent. And it went on for maybe 20 minutes, 25 minutes, both mornings, same time, same duration of time for the event. And then last night, it started to pour. And it drizzled and drizzled and drizzled all night. There was no footsteps. I didn't hear a thing. And even though the rain had calmed down by the morning, there was no footsteps. So whether it was, you know, crazy woods people or whoever had gone to the camp, you know, the night before, they didn't feel like coming out in the rain, so.
Now, is there a lot of reports from that campsite besides that one that you heard? I mean, have you heard of other reports that have happened right there in the campsite?
Yeah, the reported ones, and actually the one that I found, the documented, was at the campsite. And the other documented from Salt Fork last year was on a trail where a guy said he thought he heard talking, but it wasn't normal talking, so he looked and saw two creatures. But that was one of the most recent ones. But yeah, there has been definite reports from the, especially the primitive side, it seems.
There's so much that goes on in that Salt Fork State Park. It seems like in Ohio, that's all you ever hear about is that area.
Yeah, it's a huge park, you know, 17,000 acres. There's 3,000 acres worth of water. And it's creepy. You walk down through the forest, and like it's a nice dark place.
Yeah.
And Will, shame on you for saying that about using your book for kindling. I would never do that.
Well, I've told Wes, I said, you know, you could have taken two of them and rubbed them together to start a fire.
No. I was like, that's my book. I'm amazing at that thing.
Appreciate it, Shannon. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, guys. It was a pleasure.
We're pleased to bring on the show this evening our anthropologist from the Bay Area, Mark Dobbs. Mark's a forensic anthropologist and a really, really sharp guy. He knows his stuff, and his insights will be a big help.
Hey, how you doing?
Pretty good, pretty good. How are you this evening?
Good.
Our first guest tonight is Dina from the Snohomish area of North Central Washington. How are you, Dina?
Not too bad. Really looking forward to sharing some stuff, actually.
Oh, absolutely. We also have an anthropologist on the phone with us, Mark Dobbs. And so
Great. We
wanted to, he's going to kind of give us feedback, and then we'll all just kind of ask questions as we go.
All right.
Let's go, first of all, tell us what you knew about the subject of Bigfoot before you saw or encountered anything.
My family, I kind of grew up knowing about it because of things that went on at our house. My grandparents, they had issues, so I kind of grew up hearing about it all the time.
And what part of the country was that?
Snohomish, Maltby, Washington, actually.
Okay, well, let's just kind of start with the beginning, and maybe tell us, you know, some of the things you heard from your parents and grandparents growing up.
Well, my grandparents, I mean, I remember specifically phone calls that my grandpa would call and talk to my dad on the phone, and we always knew he was upset because his freezer kept getting, you know, got into, and it's kind of funny because just the other day I was listening to one of your shows, and I heard almost the exact same thing, and I kind of laughed about it. Except for the door kept getting left open. He had an outside freezer on the outside porch, and my grandpa's an avid hunter. Like, you walk into his place, and there would be pelts, deer heads, bear skins, wolves, you name it. He had it, hunted them himself. And whatever was going on, you know, I remember as a kid thinking, he's extremely disturbed. Like, he was freaked out. And he had two hunting dogs, Zip and, I can't remember the other one's name. One particular incident with the freezer and the dogs wouldn't come out. And this call issue went on over and over where he would call my dad. And the reason he was calling my dad, I found out, was that he actually believed that Tom, my brother, who was living at my grandparents' at the time, was stealing from the freezer and leaving the freezer door open. And, you know, it's kind of silly in retrospect. I think, realistically, he was grasping for straws. As time went on, obviously, that wasn't the case. You know, Tom was put under a third degree over it, swears he didn't do it. I think my grandpa knew he didn't do it. And one night, everything kind of came to a head. My dad had had enough, and he went over there. And as the story goes, I wasn't there. As the story goes, they were standing in the kitchen, and my grandma was telling my dad about other things that she had seen. She had seen one creature, she called it, walking away from the back door into the trees. Now, the tree line came straight up, like, literally probably 3 feet from the back window where the kitchen is. That was, like, that as far back as I can remember. But she saw it walking away. She didn't know what it was, but it was huge. And she had told my grandpa that. I don't know what my grandpa did with it. You have to figure during that time I'm between the ages of 6 and 9 years old. So it's not like grown-ups sat around and talked to the kids about what was going on. We got to catch what we caught. That was it. Needless to say, as the story goes, and I have talked to my dad about this as an adult just to kind of figure out exactly what happened. So anyways, he's standing there. My grandma's going on about what she's seen, what she's heard. And my grandpa, he's just had it because deer, pieces of deer, whether it be hindquarter or flank, meat is missing all the time from his freezer. And the freezer's getting left open. And, you know, to my grandpa, that's like the worst possible insult you could ever give him is to steal his meat that he worked his butt off to get. Needless to say, my dad's standing there, and the story goes like this. He turned around talking to my grandma and saw someone standing in the window of the kitchen. So that's it. My dad, you know, ex-Marine, goes flying out the back door. He's going to confront this hoodlum or whatever he thinks it is. I have no idea. Goes around the back of the house. There's nobody there. And he looks up to where the window is. It's about 11 feet off the ground. And his exact words are, he felt like he couldn't breathe. Like, literally someone punched him in the stomach. All the air went out of him. You know, looking at him, I guess watching your father retell something and you still see that fresh fear in their face, even after so many years. I myself, I've been, you know, piqued with interest over it ever since I was about 19 when I had a, you know, full adult experience. And I had one when I was a kid, but I guess, I don't know, it didn't affect me the same, I guess. I'm what you call obsessed.
Your first encounter was when you were a child?
Yeah, yeah. My dad, he was a truck driver, and he frequently would get home really late and then have to turn around and get up really early and stuff. And this one night he was coming home, and my mom said, you know, we had a pretty small house, and my sister and I shared one room, and my mom put us on the floor in the living room. And in our sleeping bags, and my mom was going to sleep on the couch right there in the living room, too. My dad was to get home and take my sister and I's bedroom and so that he could, you know, have quiet sleep, whatever, and get up at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, whatever time that was, and leave again. So apparently I wasn't awake when he got home because I don't remember him getting there or anything. What I do remember is the next thing I know, basically, he is standing there whisper yelling at my mom. Like, they're face-to-face, and I'm looking at him, and I'm laying on the floor, and I'm looking at him, but I'm afraid to look him in the eye because I'm afraid he'll see me with my eyes open. So I look at my sister, who's facing me. She has her eyes open. We're staring at each other, listening to my dad, and he says, it's going to kill me. It's coming through the wall, and he's freaking out. And I look up at him again. He has no color, none, in his face. He's almost green. I was probably 7 when that happened, and again, with seeing your protector, somebody who's big and strong, be like that is really traumatizing, to say the least. Apparently, he had gone in to go to bed, and something was beating on the walls, hitting the windows, scratching, and he thought for sure that it was going to come through the wall, and it was going to kill him. I mean, he just kept saying it over and over and over again, that it's going to get him. It's going to kill him. And my mom is trying to soothe him, trying to make him feel better, telling him it was probably a dream. My mom knew better. She had had her own experience, but I guess faced with the situation, she didn't know what else to do. The next morning, my sister and I get up, and my dad's gone. He went outside and around the side of the house where our window was, and the windowsill was gone. The house that we lived in, it was built probably in the early 1900s, and it had windowsills on the outside of the house that stuck out probably 5 or 6 inches. The windowsill was gone. Gone. Like, I don't know how to explain it. Like if you stood on it and busted it off, right. The grass looked like somebody had taken a pitchfork, not a rake, a pitchfork, and scraped the ground. There were rocks everywhere in the grass. which we had rocks in our driveway, but there weren't rocks in the grass. So, you know, that was something else. I only recently realized that there was more outside going on with the Bigfoot thing other than BFRO only about probably 3 months ago. I have nothing to do with the BFRO. They irritate me, so I don't have anything to do with them. But to me, that's all there was. And it was really very pathetic what, you know, there was. And so I'm very, very surprised to find your guys' show, and just, you know, it inspired me to want to share. And I've never reported anything on the BFRO. I had absolutely no desire to do so, because there's a lot that, believe it or not, you block out when you're a kid. I guess it's to make it okay. When it comes to, and I don't want to offend anybody, when it comes to people who believe that this is a lovable pet or something, I just have one thing to say, and that is, throughout the 6 or 7 experiences that I can remember clearly, never have I felt comfortable. Never have I felt like I am being loved by something. I have never felt the need to hug it. I have been terrified to my soul. And so based on that, I can only say that obviously I'm getting that feeling because it's not a lovable teddy bear. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. I know exactly what you're saying.
Yeah. So, and yeah, I mean, I say that.
Situation, I can relate.
Did your father say, or did it ever come out later in the years why the thing went off like it did? Did he go off? I mean, did your dad do? He never.
No.
It just came falling off.
These kinds of things, when they would happen, they were not talked about. They were not dealt with in any way, shape, or form.
Walk us through your experiences from the beginning and then move forward in time.
When we moved into that place, so you have to understand my family owned it. Before we moved in, I moved in when I was 4. I'm the youngest of 8 kids. Basically, all of my siblings are all, you know, a lot older than I am, like 20 years my senior. So they weren't living there at the time. It was my sister and I and my brother Terry. My sister's 2 years older than me. My brother Terry is 6 years older than me. What I remember, I was always afraid of that room. We used to hear banging all the time. All the time. Like every night. Like every single night. There was banging. And like somebody would run their hand on the wall. Like if you were to open your hand and run it on the wall. Like slide it across the wall. That sound. That was a normal sound. My sister and I frequently would crawl to the bottom of the bed and sleep at the bottom of the bed as far away from the window as we possibly could. The situation financially that our family was in, it wasn't like my family could just go, oh, well, you know, this is uncomfortable with the kids, let's move. It wasn't like that. You know, this is in the 70s, and, you know, things weren't that great in that aspect. I had a great childhood. What I remember with that was not great. This happened, I would say, 180 days out of a year. And I think that's probably the only thing that kept most of us sane, is that there was quiet times. My first actual, I know what it was that I saw and what it was, I was 11. We had had a fort out of the property of the mill. My sister and I had built a fort. It was plywood in a triangle shape, open front, closed back. We put it deep back in the woods. And the idea there, my sister being 2 years older than me, is that we would sneak out. And, you know, because she was into the boy thing and what have you, and she had to take me with. That's literally the way it went. One night, we snuck out, and everything was fine, and my dad was going to be home around dawn, and we knew we had to get back to the fort and basically ditch cars the whole way home so that, you know, our dad didn't catch us. We ditched cars. We made it back to the backside of the property where my great uncle Leo had his trailer. Well, he's also a hunter. So we knew that we couldn't just mosey in the backside of the property. He'd hear us. So we had to, like, be really quiet. When we got into the woods, I'll never forget it. It was like being in a different world. These are my woods. I, you know what I mean? I know them. You either felt comfortable or you didn't. There was never a medium, a middle ground.
it was either okay or it wasn't. And this particular time, it was so on the other side of okay that none of us could even, three little girls, 11 and two 13-year-olds, scared so bad that we know we can't go back to the house. So we're all walking, holding on to each other. It's so quiet. This is something that, it was so quiet that if I had whispered, hey, it would have probably sounded like it came through a bullhorn. It was so quiet. We got back to where the fort was, and I remember we all crawled in and we just held on to each other. Like, none of us had said a word. I mean, it was just the weirdest thing when I look back on it. None of us had said a word to each other the whole way. And when we got in there, there was a dead mouse, a perfectly healthy dead mouse. And I know that that sounds weird, but there was absolutely nothing wrong with this mouse. It was just dead. And it was inside of our sleeping bag with the covers pulled up and everything, which is fine. Mice can die, whatever. I'll let that go. When we got in, it was probably 15 seconds, maybe 30 seconds, between us getting in and this thing walking in front of the fort. And it took 5 steps total. It blocked out the light. It was probably a 3-foot triangle, the front of our fort, about a 3-foot triangle, right on the ground. This thing blocked out the light when it took its first step in front, and we only heard one step. And this is important because I'm an analytical mind, and I didn't hear it coming, which means it was already there. And that geeks me to no end, pretty much. It took 5 steps, and in those 5 steps, it managed to cross through our fort area and across the creek into our neighbor's property. And that was probably 10 yards. That was my first actual experience. The size of this thing's leg, this is false dawn. It's not pure black outside. It's a false dawn. It's kind of gray, I guess, is the right terminology.
Right,
and it blacked, exactly, it blacked out that 3.5-foot triangle front of our lean-to tent thing that we made out of plywood. And it was, you know, stomp, 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 stomp. It wasn't da-da-da, da-da-da, like a 4-legged. This was clear and concise. There you go. The whole right side of my body literally almost felt like it caught on fire. And I don't know why that is, except for the fact that I think I walked right by it. That's the only thing that I can think of, because my adrenaline reaction to it, even at 11 years old, was like the whole right side of my body was on fire. Like, maybe I was within a foot of it when I walked into the camp. That was my first experience. We, of course, laid there holding on to each other for probably 20, 25 minutes, if that, just enough to where we knew that we could see a little farther in the woods, and we hightailed it out of there. We never slept out there again. Never slept out there again. It kind of freaks me out, because I think, why did we sleep out there in the first place? You know what I mean? There was so much going on there. I wonder, I mean, we used to play war games out on our property in the dark, wearing dark clothes, my brothers. But see, I had 6 brothers. So, you know, maybe that's why it was okay. I really honestly don't know. I don't know what was going through our heads half the time, because half the time we were doing things that I'm looking at it from an adult point of view now going, you're nuts. There's no way. The other half the time we were terrified. So in one part of it, we were acting like we didn't have a care in the world. And, I mean, maybe that's a response to having, you know, parents that are completely not there. I mean, I don't know. Maybe this is how kids cope. I don't know. I mean, that's how we coped. So I don't know if that's right or dysfunctional or what.
So how long was it till the next incident?
We moved when I was 12. So we were only there for probably about another 8 or 10 months after that incident. And we moved to Spokane. And then my next incident, I was 19. And that was a two-night incident. That was a 2 days in a row.
And that was in the Spokane area?
No. That was in Port Townsend, Port Hadlock.
Oh, up in the Peninsula. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yep. And I was with my ex-husband. He was my boyfriend at the time. We were in a fifth wheel, and we were in the fifth wheel sleeping, and I heard this scream that didn't stop. It just kept going and going and going and going and going and going, and it lasted probably about 30 seconds of just solid screaming. I used to be a singer, and I can tell you without a shadow of a doubt that in order for me to scream at the top of my lungs to have that kind of sound, there's no way that I could hold it for more than 15 seconds, maybe, if I'm really good. And this thing held this scream up and down and up and down for a long time. It made my lip quiver. It lasted so long. It was incredible. I tried to wake my boyfriend up. Where we were sleeping was his mom's property, and his mom had 17 geese. Geese are great watchdogs. They are wonderful. They're better than any dog could ever be. These geese, I actually checked the next day because I thought they were gone or dead because they made no noise. None. This thing is screaming, and it's dead quiet everywhere. I tried to wake my boyfriend up, and at the time I didn't know he had a sleep disorder, which I found out later. He was like he was dead. I was shaking him, and he was just a limp noodle. And I was hysterical because this thing, while it was screaming, was one thing, but when it stopped screaming is when I really got scared. When something is yelling like that, you can get a placement, you can get a bead on how far away its elevation, things like that. You know, you go through your Rolodex in your mind of what you know, the known things that you know. And it wasn't fitting anything. It was scary while it was screaming, but when it stopped is when everything changed, literally. All I could think of, its position was at the top of this trail that was about a quarter mile long. We're at the bottom, literally in a valley, at the bottom of this trail, and in a fifth wheel. And in the fifth wheel, there's a hole in the floor. Not the greatest place in the whole wide world, but this is the way it was. I tried to wake Mark up. He wouldn't wake up. The silence lasted and lasted and lasted. Somehow, I managed to go back to sleep. The next morning, I was yelling at Mark because I was so scared. I didn't know what to do with myself, and he wouldn't wake up. That was when I found out that he had a sleep disorder that was really bad, and that he would, like, be a dead person. I mean, he'd have a pulse and breathe, but you would not be able to wake him up for nothing. I was hysterical. The next night, and you have to understand, during the day, I told him, I said, if that happens again, ever, I said, I'll hit you with a baseball bat. I will not go through that alone. I will not. And the next night, almost on cue, I get woke up to this thing screaming bloody murder from the same exact place. I grab Mark by the hair. Wake up. I'm going to pull his lips. I'll do whatever it takes. I'm not going through this by myself. He wakes up. Now it's quiet. The thing has stopped screaming. I'm freaking out. I'm quietly freaking out because I don't want to make a noise. I'm in a little tin fifth wheel with a hole in the floor. I don't have that. I don't feel protected or safe in any way, shape, or form at this point. We're sitting there. We're whispering to each other as to what we think it is, where we think it is. Let's see if we can hear footsteps. Can we hear anything? There's no noise at all. I start lifting up the blinds up in the bed area because that's where we're at. There's little blinds. I parted the blinds. There are three ornamental cherry trees that are probably 10 to 15 feet tall along this area where we're parked. Okay, so you have the shadows of the tree, you know, with the darkness behind it. So you can see the difference in darkness from the tree to the dark of the actual night. There's a shadow standing right there next to the tree. And it is right at my level. I'm up in a fifth wheel. It's right at my head level, less than 2 feet. If that wall wasn't there, it'd be less than 2 feet away from me. I'm not dumb. I knew exactly what it was. I almost had a coronary. At that moment, I don't know if Mark saw it because I was the one looking out the window. He jumped up in his underwear, grabbed his knife, and goes flying out the door. And he's yelling, Sutherland, this guy. He's yelling this guy's name, that they're enemies. And I'm like, the hell? He goes out the door. Now, I'm there by myself with this thing that I don't want to look out the blinds to see if it's still there or now Mark's dead. But see, now I'm the chick in the car that ends up dead, you know, that you see in all the movies.
Like the horror movies.
There you go. I am literally living the horror movie. Yeah. I am the girl in the car. My boyfriend just left to get killed. And that thing will be popping up through the hole in the floor any second now. I mean, I'm playing this all in my head. Probably, I mean, I have to be realistic. 3 minutes go by. Felt like half an hour. 3 or 4 minutes went by, and the door flies open. I screamed because, again, I'm still playing that I'm going to die over and over. The door flies open. It's Mark, and he's standing there, and his face is white as a sheet, and he's screaming at me at the top of his lungs. Did you see that? What the fuck was that? And he's losing it. There's spit coming out of his mouth. He is absolutely gone. He looks like, I mean, if you berserk, he went insane, like crazy. He lost his mind completely right there. These are my woods. He's screaming this at the top of his lungs. These are my woods. I built that trail. I know where every root, every corner. I chased that MF thing up the, do you know what it did? It went left. And I'm just sitting there. I've got tears streaming out of my eyes because I'm scared. I don't know if he's going to kill me now, you know, because he's so freaked out. I don't know what to do. And he keeps saying it went left. I don't know what that means. So finally I said, so what? And he said, do you know what left is? No. He says, it's sticker bushes. That's it. It's just sticker bushes. And he goes, and this thing went through it like it was nothing. Needless to say, he chased this thing because in his infinite wisdom, he thought it was his rival enemy standing outside of the fifth wheel. And only upon chasing it through a trail he broke, he couldn't catch it. He said he could not. He couldn't even get close to it. He was at the bottom of the hill when it was in the middle of the hill and it went left. He saw it clear as day. And I said, what did you see? And he said it was black. And it was huge. And I said, why did you continue to chase it? And I have to understand, we're not having a conversation in any way. We're both at this point screaming our heads off at each other because we're both terrified. You know, reiterating this is kind of funny because it sounds so neatly packaged and it so was not neatly packaged at all. I've known my whole life that they are there, that they are real, and that I've never had a warm and fuzzy feeling when I'm around them. So they're not something I want to hang around with or give a hug to.
I'm kind of curious, Mark, what's your thoughts on some of the behavior that Dina's been talking about and through her experiences?
Well, I mean, it fits into, if we're talking about a primate, especially a great ape, that would be territorial, but they would also be curious, would have a big brain, relatively sophisticated cognition compared to other mammals. It fits into what we call the primate continuum of behavior. So it's not something that I would be suspicious about necessarily as far as the story goes. The stories that I hear that involve the playful, the trusting, the approachable, primate that just kind of wants to play around and is curious and wants to say hi, that does not strike me as being something that fits, because primates are very territorial, very protective of areas. So if the behavior fits, what I haven't heard a whole lot of the story is descriptions, physical descriptions, other than being a big black shadow. So if there's any more detail on that, I'd be interested to hear that.
Unfortunately.
Expressing to us is very typical of these type of encounters, these behaviors.
It sounds like a lot of the encounters happened at night, so it's hard to get a good view of what you're seeing. I mean, the behaviors with the house, we've heard that so many. How many times have you heard that, Will?
Oh, a half a dozen at least in recent months.
Yeah, right. In recent months. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, I guess.
It's very, very typical, some of these accounts.
You know, like I said, I'm pretty much obsessed, but I do this stuff by myself. I don't know of any other databases. I don't know, because I just kind of thought there was nothing out there. I really honestly thought that what was out there was just shit, to be absolutely honest, and not worth me even looking into.
There's a lot of junk out there, that's for sure.
Yeah, and so when I came across, you know, your guys' talk show on YouTube, I was floored.
That night, now what did you and Mark do after? Did you leave that night, or did you leave the next day? Or?
No. We ended up staying. We stayed in that fifth wheel in that exact place for another 5 or 6 months, and nothing else happened. I mean, not that I heard.
Just those two. Exactly.
Why? Now, I have no idea.
Did you have any more encounters after that?
Yeah.
Time period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
The only problem with the encounters, and you know, I've listened to a lot of the episodes, and a lot of people have Class A encounters. I don't. I get screamed at. That's pretty much what I get.
In the primate world, what's the deal with the screaming? Now, a lot of the encounters that we hear are kind of like Dina's, where it comes up, it sees where they're at, and it screams. We've talked to a lot of people to where they kind of all run into each other. One screams, or, you know, the people scream, and then it's like the Sasquatch screams, and they kind of run in different directions. Is that, like in Dina's case, if it's standing up, looking down, is it like, do you think it's a warning to the rest of them, or do you think it's an intimidation? What are your thoughts on it?
Well, there's a whole range of vocalizations, and they all have kind of different meanings and have different contexts. So it's kind of impossible to say exactly what it was doing, you know, for sure. But it's certainly within reason to suggest that it was either a threat vocalization, just a simple surprise vocalization, which could have been, you know, which humans have to, could have been a vocalization to the rest of a troop. So it's difficult to say, but again, I think kind of the key thing is there, it's what you would expect, right? So even though we don't know the full context and what it was doing, it's if you're going to suggest that that's what she encountered, then that's certainly within what you would expect in the, you know, using other primates as an analogy.
I kind of wonder with the time frame, you know, they were there for 5 months, and this only happened the first couple of nights over there. I mm-hmm. wonder if maybe the group was in that particular feeding area, and maybe that was the sentry, you know, warning the rest that they were there, and then they moved on, and that's why they didn't hear or experience anything further.
It kind of makes sense because nobody had been staying in that fifth wheel for obvious reasons with a hole in the floor. And Mark and I only moved into it. It was late spring, early summer. And I know that because there was no hole in the floor, or there was a hole in the floor. And there's, you know, the only reason that it was okay to stay in there is that it was warm enough at night that we wouldn't freeze our tushes off.
Thank you for coming on, Dina. We really do appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks very much. I'll keep you guys posted if anything else comes up.
Yeah, please do.
Yeah, I will, definitely. And thanks for being there. You guys are doing a great job. I absolutely love your show.
Oh, thank you so much.
You bet.
Well, Woody and I went out to the Brown property. I've never seen so much and heard so much going on in one place. So we get out of the car. John and Sarah are kind enough to walk us around the property. As we start walking around the property, we stop in this one area, and it's not a great place to cast tracks. There's so much foliage on the ground, but in a few areas there's mud. And Woody goes, "Hey, look, a footprint." And we look down, and right in the mud, right in front of us, there's this footprint. And we all kind of stop, we look at it, and Woody's like, "Hey, look over here. Here's another footprint." So we go walk over, start looking at that one. I'm telling Woody, "Hey, let's get pictures of these footprints." About the time he pulls out his phone, off to our right, And it's in really dense brush. There's barbed wire. There's a barbed wire fence around this other outside of John and Sarah's property. And we hear this vocalization. And it kind of sounded like the yip yeller Sarah has. It was going, yip, yip, yip. But it sounded really deep, and it sounded just odd sounds. So we walk over to that area, and we're listening, and it stops. We start walking up this barbed wire fence, and the only way I can describe it is it was like monkey chatter. We'd hear monkey chatter kind of off in the brush, and I'd kind of look back at Woody, and I'd point over in that area, and he'd stop, and he'd listen. And it was like just constant kind of like monkey chatter. It was just real, the vocalizations we were getting was just kind of, you get a real short chatter and then it would stop. And then you get a real short chatter and it'd stop. And as we walked up this fence line, that's what we were getting. We're getting this constant kind of like, I guess, monkey chatter, just different chatter going on, but it'd be kind of off about 70 yards from us. It seemed like it paced us and kept about 70 yards away, and we'd hear this chatter going on. As we start walking around the property, I notice, I always kind of call BS on stick structures whenever you see them on Facebook, but they kind of have that going on their property, but it's more primitive than what you see on Facebook. On Facebook and all these other sites, you see all these elaborate stick structures. That's not really what they have going on there. It's definite stick structures, but it's more like in Sarah's case, and I kind of pointed it out to her, I said that it's almost like it was kind of creating a blind, like a deer blind, and they were getting close. You'd have one, and then you'd walk 30 feet, and you'd have another one sitting there, and you'd walk 30 feet, and you'd have another one sitting there. But the odd thing is it was going in the direction of their house, so it's almost like it was setting up these little stick structures kind of going in their direction. The other thing about the stick structures was, on a lot of them, I'm talking 6-7 inch branches that were snapped and put up against trees. And I went to lift one of them off, and this thing had to weigh about 200, at least 200 pounds. Like, I could barely lift it up off this tree. We kept seeing all these weird structures, so we leave that area. We go down to this area. I think Sarah and John call it the boneyard, but it's where they always find bones that have been stripped of all the flesh. And I picked one of them up, and it looked like someone with a person's, like, big molars had been kind of chewing on the bone. Now, it could have been another animal, but to me it looked like a mouth wrapped around it and was kind of chewing on the bone. The bones weren't broken, but they were definitely all stripped of flesh, were kind of in this one area on their property, almost like something sits there and eats. So we walk through the property, and there's this open field on their property. When you see it at first, it looks level, but it's not. It's kind of got these dips and, where like there was old rivers that went through there. So it would be a good, great place to hide out there if you want to lay down. But we walk all the way through this field, and on the other side of their property is the Chehalis River. We go up next to the Chehalis River, and it's like a toddler. It was like a toddler crying, or a toddler, just a real weird, it sounded like a monkey trying to mimic like a toddler crying. And that's the only way to describe it. That's what it sounded like. And I look back at Sarah and Woody, and Woody's face is like, his eyes are wide open, and Sarah's eyes are wide open. And we're kind of looking down on the river, and so I called down to the river, just maybe I misheard it, maybe it was a person down there, and there was no one, no response back. But I swear there was like almost like a monkey doing like a toddler cry, or trying to mimic some sort of toddler cry. But all day long we were getting these vocals, I would say probably every 15 to maybe 20 minutes, but they were 70 to 200 yards away from us. So it was never really close to us, but it's like constant all day long. It was nonstop vocals. As soon as the sun goes down, we go back and we sit around the fire. And as the sun, it's getting dark, the coyotes start up in the background. And then we hear this just, whoa! I mean, and it just held it for this long, like a lion roaring, and then holding it for, God, it seemed like forever. It probably held it for a good 30 to 45 seconds. It just held this long roar. And then all the coyotes just got quiet. Probably 15, 20 minutes later, we hear this just, whoa, it just goes off again. Again, it lasts probably 30 seconds, 45 seconds. all through the night we would hear, you know, just weird, you know, Woody and I and John were walking around. I heard a whoop. We heard screams. There were some screams out there. We get up in this tree stand with his night vision camera, or not night, it's a thermal. And John's panning the open field. And he goes, hey, check that out. There's a heat signature out there, like standing in the field. So I put my eyes on it. I look through the thermal. Sure enough, it's like a person kind of standing out in the field, like a blob squatch. The thermal couldn't zoom in on it, and it was probably a good 200, 300 yards from us. So we all get down, and we're walking through the forest, and we're well-armed. And we get out to the open area to where we see where this heat signature was. And as we start walking towards it, we get this chatter off to our left. But it sounded a little bit closer than what it had been all day. But we get this weird chatter off to our left. So like idiots, we all stop and we all take the thermal off the heat signature and we're scanning the field trying to find out where this chatter's coming from off to our left. Scan the field, couldn't see anything. So we go back to look at the original heat signature and it's gone. Whatever's standing in the field took off. John and Sarah, they have a lot of stories about their property and their grandfather. Where their house actually sits, their grandfather had a fish shack there. And the kind of going on with Dina's story, these things would come open, break open the fish shack, steal the fish. And the grandfather and the Sasquatch didn't have a great relationship because they kept stealing his fish, breaking his shack. But everyone around that area views it as the same as like a bear or a cougar or everyday type of animal. No one, it's not like it's huge mystery to the people that are living in this area. It's like after a while, like John and Sarah, it's almost like living next to a train track. You never hear the train after a while. But being there, I was just like constant vocals going on. And I was just kind of curious on your take and your, you know, with the whole primate. I should have snapped pictures of the trees to kind of show you what I was talking about.
Yeah, the tree structures, the stick structures are interesting. Humans are the only primates that make structures as far as shelters, I should say. I mean, other than nests, right? So we know that gorillas and some other primates create nests. But as far as structures to keep out elements and so on or to hide themselves, as far as we know, primates only use kind of what already exists in nature. They don't necessarily build things. But again, you know, there's no way to say that's not possible. I mean, certainly with the relatively big brain, flexible, generalized limbs with the prehensile hands and things like that. I mean, multiple things are possible as far as that goes. It's interesting that you mentioned the fish shack because what I was thinking, before you even got to it, I was kind of thinking to myself, you know, if you have a group of these things that are living there, that are staying there, and they choose to stay there and opt to stay there, you know, I was thinking, well, I wonder what it is that's keeping them there at the risk of being discovered or having a confrontation or whatever. But kind of a consistent source of protein like fish, which is a huge protein source and an easy protein source if somebody else had to catch it, would certainly want to keep a group around. It also made me think of other interactions that humans have with primates as far as, you know, you have the macaques who, you know, steal food right out of the grocery stores in India, and you have baboons in South Africa that are, you know, breaking in people's cars and stealing things. So, I mean, primates definitely have learned to exploit human culture and human habitation and human patterns. So that fits, you know, it's something that certainly fits. And by the way, I probably want to just kind of apologize just for a second, just for being so kind of focused on primates, because it would be my assumption that if these things, you know, if they're real and you know, you've seen them and other people have seen them, I have not, but if someone's going to suggest that they're real, then as an anthropologist, it fits in the whole order primate to me. And so that's my focus. And so if it seems narrow, that's my expertise and that's kind of what I go off of. And if they are real, then there's no reason to put them anywhere else than in the order primate. All the phenotypic, the physical descriptions and behavior fits squarely in there. As far as the vocalizations go, again, vocalizing is a huge part of primate behavior. Primates evolved first in arboreal environments where you have trees, a lot of dense foliage, the canopy, multiple levels of the canopy, and even though they have good vision, color vision, stereoscopic vision with depth perception, in a dense vegetation environment, you can't necessarily see all the predators that are coming from down below, from up above. You can't see all the other species that you are cohabiting with. And so, you know, vocalizations are very, very important. And so they have multiple, not just a small range of vocalizations, but a very large range. The Guenons of Africa have vocalizations for every different kind of predator and different species that are around them. And these are vocalizations to warn, you know, of danger from the air in the form of an eagle, or danger from the ground in the form of a big cat or something. So it makes, you know, it fits. The whole thing fits. So nothing that you're saying, other than the stick structures, which baffle me a bit, and they always kind of have. But again, who am I to say that needs to be thrown out? But aside from that, I mean, it all seems very, very interesting. And the fact that they are persisting in that area, or whatever it is persisting in that area, again fits with the primate thing. Primates, they're willing to say, okay, let's adapt to this environment. And if that environment means dealing with the humans and what they bring and what the threats are, you know, they're not necessarily gonna just scamper away and find a new place. At least we have plenty of evidence from the New World, you know, Central and South America, the Old World, Africa, and India, of primates and monkeys in particular, really adapting to humans and to human behavior. So yeah, I think it's very interesting. I think it's certainly worth continuing to look into.
You know, there's the established group, and the Browns say there are four individuals, and there may be more, we don't know, in that group. And there's occasionally, outside of, and where these markings are that Wes was talking about, these stick structures or X's, I mean, they're very simplistic markings, but there's a group of three, they're probably rogue males, that will come and scream occasionally. They know the differences. And Wes, you said that's kind of the demarcation line. They don't go past that marking. Is that right?
Yeah. No, one thing I wanted to say, Mark, is I love that you're going on the, you know, with the primate side of it. So I don't feel like it's short-sighted at all, because that's what I'd love to hear. What I saw, I think, is a primate. I mean, it definitely fitted kind of a large chimp or an oversized ape, or they just walked and acted different than any monkey I've ever seen. But yeah, on their property with these stick structures, Will's right. They have this one area on the edge of their property, and there is like kind of a big X. Obviously, I'm reading into it being an X, but that's kind of the formation of the stick structure. And the rogue males, or they think that are rogue males, there's almost like another group over on the other side of this, on the other side of the Chehalis River. And they never cross over into where John and Sarah talk about this family group being in this one area. They just kind of, they'll come up to the edge of that, kind of where these stick structures are, and I'm first to be skeptical about stick structures. I kind of called BS on it until I went out to Sarah and John's place and saw it firsthand. But this other group, and she has lots of recordings from both groups, they never really come into each other's territory, or they never really cross paths, but they'll come on the edge of kind of where the stick structures are at, and they'll scream and yell and cause all kind of hell at night and sometimes during the day.
Definitely with primates, there is, especially, well, for example, chimpanzees, there definitely is to their territories, you know, the home range, which would be the entire territory, then the core area where most of the resources are found, where the females and the infants would be spend most of their time. And there's definitely, so there's definitely an edge to that home range, and that's where the males of the group patrol around, right, to make sure that there's nobody, you know, trespassing or trying to take their resources. So, you know, and of course the other chimps that would be threatening for resources would a lot of times be bachelor males, that themselves don't have mates, and so they need to displace an alpha, that kind of thing. So so there is a continual threat of the kind of the core group being threatened by others from outside the group, from outside the home range, that are trying to come in and displace male and to kind of take over. So, I mean, no, but I've not heard that there's any kind of artificial or constructed demarcation for that, for the edge of that home range. It's just kind of a known line or known area. It's all very, very interesting, and it's certainly worthy of further investigation. But it would be unique. But on the other hand, the whole idea of a Sasquatch, Bigfoot, is unique, right, in primates. So we can't be completely dogmatic about it and say, well, we only see it in chimps, therefore we would only expect it, you know, this range of behavior in a Sasquatch. So we have to leave room for the possibility of unique behaviors or characteristics, because what we're talking about is, as far as we know, very unique.
You know, it's interesting, too, about the, you know, the males patrolling the outer edges of their range. With the Sasquatch, most of the time, and probably somewhere between 70 and 90% of the sightings are males. And that really supports that, with the females and the young being deeper into the territory and the males being seen by humans because they're out, you know, on, you know, patrolling that that perimeter and being in, you know, closer proximity to humans than the females and the young are.
Well, yeah, that brings up a very interesting point. When it comes to the whole evolution of bipedality, of walking on two legs, and that is the theory of provisioning. And that is that a male who may not necessarily have been the biggest and the strongest and the most ferocious and so on, with bipedality, with the ability to walk on two legs, that individual had the ability to travel a distance and bring back resources or provision to a female and thereby attract that female as far as being a mate. So that would certainly give females and infants an advantage to be able to stay in a rather confined area while the males who are competing for them, you know, rather than necessarily fighting each other with brute strength, they would be competing by, you know, bringing back things. And that's actually a very powerful hypothesis that has pretty much taken strong hold in the evolution of bipedality. So yeah, that really does make sense that the males would be on the margins, closer to the dangers and so on, the females would be sequestered away.
Yeah, I can't remember if Sarah said that they have ever seen the female. I don't think that they have. They've heard her, but they've never seen her. And every one of them that they've seen has always been a male. I was completely shocked when I went out there. Just a lot of the monkey chatter, too. A lot of the weird, you know...
It's a treasure house in behavioral information.
The thing, the key that unlocks it, makes it most, that would make it most useful, unfortunately, is to verify that is what in fact is the source of all the activity. Which, you know, I mean, I have no reason to disclaim it or whatever. I have no experience of it myself, so I can't say. But it's a treasure trove, but it has to be put in context. I mean, my profession, or my, you know, my main field of anthropology is forensic anthropology, and so I'm, you know, constantly looking at forensic cases and looking at the evidence that's before me, and unfortunately that really colors the way I look at things and think of things. And so even though I think that's a treasure trove of evidence, to me it's like the thing that I just really kind of pine for is being able to connect it definitively to something, so then we could say, oh, now we can study it and try to figure out what the different focalizations are and what the stick structures mean and all that kind of stuff. But again, that's for kind of people like me who are kind of locked in, unfortunately, to this way of thinking. That's kind of our burden to bear, and others are a bit more free to speculate, but it's just really hard for me to do that.
Yeah, no, I hear you on that.
Catch them in the act, basically.
Yeah, I mean, because it's the same thing with vocalizations, right? I mean, I can say that, you know, and I'm not attributing this to you in the least. I'll just speak completely for myself. But I can hear something weird in the woods that I don't recognize, and I'll say, wow, that's not anything I've ever heard before, therefore it must be something different. But you have to weigh that against the catalog that's in my head, which actually may not be that broad, right? So, you know, things like vocalizations, I'm really wary about, not because I doubt people hear things, but because I just, the catalog of vocalizations that are in the average person's head, just because someone says, I've never heard that before, therefore it must be a this or that, makes me a little nervous. But again, I'm locked into, and I'll admit it, I'm locked into a rather narrow focus of these things. It's just the way that is.
Well, you're absolutely right. And I said, even with footprints, unless you actually see the animal make the print, you can't, for 100% certain, say that's a Sasquatch, an authentic Sasquatch track.
Right. Now footprints are a little bit different. That's completely true, but I do think they're a bit more interesting. They're a bit more concrete because you can look at the context of a footprint. I mean, first of all, you can measure it physically and so on and see if it fits into the normal human range. You can look for the different anatomical features of the print. But then you can also look at the context of it. I mean, is it a bare footprint in the middle of nowhere and kind of a weird, going in a weird direction?
Right.
You know, I mean, that's now, again, not definitive, but it's a clue that maybe you need to look further there.
Mark, I wanted to ask you, and I'm going to beat this to like a dead horse. When you hear some of the vocals, and I realize you have a very scientific mind, but when you hear some of the vocals, have you heard any of the audio that Sarah had?
I don't think, I don't know, Will, if you send me that or not. You sent me something, I'm not sure if
I sent you a few, but I can resend them to you.
I'll play one for you, Mark. So here's kind of what we heard as we're walking around. That could be a person, but for just listening to it, you might think it'd be a person, but I'm telling you, when you go to the property and keep in mind, I had an AR-15 in my hand and Woody had John's got plenty of guns. So if someone's going to play games, it's very, very dangerous out there. But we heard that kind of stuff going on throughout the day.
Well, think about it for a second. You know, you said that could be a person, right? So that's a pretty important thing to say. I mean, because I was thinking of the same thing as you're playing it. That could be a person, as opposed to, wow, that sounds like a coyote or a wolf or this or that. It could be a person. Well, vocally speaking, except for maybe a deeper thorax and so on, what you would the vocalization, the sound of especially of a yell or a screech or something from one of these things should be relatively similar to a person. It's not identical, but relatively, because you're talking about something very similar, you know, similar vocal tracts and similar, you know, the shape of the throat and the thorax and everything. It should sound kind of like a person. So again, that to me is a clue that you're, again, I would not personally rule out some other mammal, but that would also, you know, that also is sort of suggestive that you might have something that needs further looking, right? So, I mean, I agree. I thought person when you're playing that. And so,
Well, no, and that's what I thought when I heard it first, except for we would hear it. So out on their property, there's no place in order to actually get to where we're walking around on their property, you kind of have to go through their property to get back there. And we'd hear it about 70 feet from us or 70 yards from us. We'd hear that going off. And then we'd walk over to another side of the property and we'd hear the identical that type of noise being directed at us.
Yeah, the context is important there too.
Yeah, no, I agree, and it's really, really interesting, and it sounds to me like you have an area that at least would be fruitful for, you know, further looking. And if you think, and by the way, so if you think that, you know, if one of the alternatives in the whole vocalization is person, then in addition to trying to find out what's making it, what you also want to try to do is eliminate the possibility that it is a person. And I'm not sure how you would do that or I don't know necessarily what would go into that without being there. But, you know, that would be another way to approach it also. But, yeah, I agree. I mean, that's very, very interesting vocalizations. Very primate.
Yeah, a lot of it was mainly, when we were out there, a lot of it was like the roars or we'd get the whoops, or we'd get, seems like when nightfall came, it was more of an animalistic type sound. And during the day, it was more of that kind of weird chatter in different directions. But it seems like as soon as nighttime came, it was more animalistic, like lion roaring going off, the screaming. It would just seem more animalistic type behavior at night.
I wonder if it wasn't like when you and I were talking earlier, Wes, where during the daytime, it maybe there's more socialization going on, and at nighttime is when they're hunting and a little more serious type behaviors.
Here's the thing that baffles me in the whole thing, and I can't remember if I talked to Jeff Meldrum about this. I think I emailed with Cliff about it, Derrickson, a little bit. When Finding Big first came out, I used it in my classes as a lesson in critical thinking. It wasn't very flattering, unfortunately, because I have some issues with it. But anyway, one of the things that really baffles me about the whole thing is that if we're talking about something that's nocturnal, that would be the only nocturnal grade ape ever that we know of. We have other nocturnal primates. The owl monkey is nocturnal. Prosimians, which are primitive primates, are nocturnal. But vast majority of monkeys and all the apes that we know of are diurnal. They're day. So, I mean, I don't know how that plays into the vocalization differences, but I would, you know, but everybody seems to say that these things are nocturnal. And my, you know, I kind of raise up my hand sheepishly and want to ask the question, you know, well, wait a minute, it would be the only one ever. Maybe the nighttime stuff is more autonomic, it's more emotional, it's more reactionary, and the daytime stuff is more communication, socialization, vocal grooming, as we call it, because they're up and they're doing. I don't know, but I mean, I guess I'd probably be the only one in the world that says that I don't know how they could be nocturnal, but I probably don't know what I'm talking about there.
Well, they actually seem to be, at least as far as the history goes, equally active day and night. And I'm not sure how that exactly works, but that seems to be the case anyway.
Yeah, I don't know that they're really nocturnal. I don't know that they're really nocturnal. Because, I mean, Woody and I had our encounter at night, but that doesn't mean they're nocturnal. It could have been, I mean, hell, sometimes I'm up at 1 o'clock in the morning. It doesn't mean I'm nocturnal. So I don't know that they're necessarily nocturnal. But it seems like a lot of encounters do happen at night.
Yeah. Well, but if you're talking about, if you're talking about the same organisms that are making the vocalizations during the day and during the night, it's reasonable to suggest that daytime ones would be different in register, in maybe even in sound, than the night ones would be, because you would expect activity patterns to be different in those periods. So that's, you know, that's kind of anecdotally an interesting and a good thing to find out.
No, that's a good point. I'll tell you another thing that I thought was weird, Mark. And again, this could have been a person, but they have this barbed wire fence on the back side of their property where we're hearing the vocalizations. On the other side of that barbed wire fence, it's completely dense forest. In there, someone had taken, or something had taken, this kind of a large branch, kind of a large stick, twisted it across the second barbed wire on the barbed wire fence, pushed it up to the top barbed wire fence, and twisted it again, and then took another huge stick and did the same thing on the bottom. And so it made this huge hole in this barbed wire fence. And what was actually going through that hole was huge. I mean, but the only thing I compare it to is maybe a bear. I mean, it was huge. It looked like someone drove a bus, and it was going into this brush. And it was you could tell something was coming in and out of this barbed wire fence. So I go up to the whatever put the stick and had kind of twisted the barbed wire fence. And I'm thinking, well, I'll just untwist this, and then that'll make sense that a person did it. And I physically couldn't untwist it. Whatever put that barbed wire fence up and held it up with this and made this hole in this barbed wire fence, it had more strength than I did. And it's like I physically couldn't get it undone, but you could tell where the hole is in the fence. You could tell a large animal was coming in and out of there. And I was asking John and Sarah, and they theorize that's where they bed down, is over on this. It's just, it's Native American land, but it's part of the Indian reservation. But they think that they bed down over in this area because that's where the bulk of the vocalizations come throughout the day. But, you know, I mean, on in the primate world, would that make sense that a primate would do something like that beyond, you know, us?
Whatever did that has to have prehensile hands, first of all, just mechanically to do it. Okay, so that rules out, you know, most mammals. I mean, everything but primates, right? Now, a lot of cognitive studies have been done with primates, with chimps, orangutans, you know, great apes. Duke University has done a lot of studies, cognitive studies of apes, you know, and what can you teach them? Can you teach them to manipulate little contraptions in order to get a food reward? And there's a, you know, there'll be like these trick boxes that they have to kind of break into by either sliding doors left and right or up or down or putting a stick inside a hole to push the door open, that kind of thing. And what they found is that with a primate, it takes them longer to learn to do that, right? And you can try to teach them, you can show them how to do that, but in the end, they're going to try to, a lot of times, they'll just try to find their own way to do it. But the important point is, it's been shown that they are absolutely able to manipulate objects, move things around in order to gain access to something or to get a food reward, something like that. So if I look at that behavior, just that behavior, if somebody tells you, okay, well, that has to be human because, you know, no other primate could do that. If someone makes a statement that no other primate could do that, well, they're wrong. So that is completely, that is on that primate continuum of behavior. And chimps and zoos, you know, not just chimps, but monkeys and apes and zoos, have done all kinds of clever things to get in and out, right, to manipulate gates and things like that. So it's you can't take that and throw it out. You know, you can't. I mean, obviously, Occam's razor suggests that the most logical explanation was that a human did it. But again, to me, the more important thing is you can't rule it out. You can't look at that and say, oh, well, that means therefore it has to be human. If what you're trying to determine is if a primate did it, you have to say, yes, that's possible.
Just the insight is awesome, man. I really appreciate it.
No problem. I mean, I'm, you know, I appreciate the show. I was never into Bigfoot or Sasquatch, you know, really ever. And then I started watching the Finding Bigfoot thing a number of years ago just because I was interested because I was teaching biological anthropology. And I wanted to just kind of peek at it for kind of as a voyeuristic exercise, I suppose. And then I just got really frustrated by it and started using the show in my class as kind of lessons in critical thinking and reasoning and so forth. But that also, by the same token, also made me look at it a little bit harder and just say to myself, well, this is interesting. It's certainly worthy of looking at. I don't know that I would ever devote my life to it, but certainly a worthy topic to look at. And with all the people that have seen things and all the encounters, you know, I'm not prepared to say that everybody's a liar or doesn't know what they're talking about.
What is your take on people report eyeshine? And I think Will and I have theorized that it depends on the light you hit them with. Sometimes people report this red eye shine. Sometimes people report different color eye shines. Most primates don't have eye shine, do they?
Well, no, they can. No, just about anything can have a certain amount of eye shine. But it does depend on the light that's hitting it, right? The other thing to remember is this: that in any species, in any organism, there's going to be variation, right? Variation size, shape, color, variation in eye shine. Right? You know, you can't necessarily take one color of eye shine and attribute that to, you know, you can't make an eye shine index and say it's this color, therefore it's a mountain lion or a bear or a black bear or a grizzly, right? Because there's a whole continuum of variation. You know, I don't have a problem with eye shine, but what you know, we see eye shine all the time in when you're taking pictures of people in their eyes, right? Their eyes light up weird ways.
We see that all
the time. It just happens. The thing is, but the luminescent eyes, right? The illuminating eyes, the ones that are kind of generating their own light, that's ridiculous.
It is. I don't buy that either.
Reflecting light, no problem with. You know, glowing red, that just is weird.
Well, I guess I shouldn't ask if you think they have superpowers. I'm just joking.
Well, you can ask if they have superpowers, and I guess my answer would be no, but then my answer would be I don't know. But my next answer would be if they do, then I'm done with the conversation because you don't need a scientist. You need somebody else, right? that's, you know.
Somebody doing mind speak.
Which, hey, and who knows, you know, strange things happen, and that may be the case. But if it is the case, then I'll have to kind of bow out and say, well, you know, it's not how I roll.
Yeah. So you're on the sane side of the portal?
Yeah. Well, and in fact, that's why when I kind of first started looking at this just from an interesting standpoint, and I happened upon different podcasts, and some were just so ridiculous I couldn't stand them for 5 minutes. And so when I found yours, I was kind of so excited. I emailed Will and said, gosh, I'm really excited about your podcast because you guys are looking at this from a natural standpoint, and you try to apply the anthropological perspective to it to a certain extent, and I was just so excited. Maybe I got a little too excited, but anyway, I'm on the same side of the portal.
I was thinking, Mark, my girlfriend was telling me about when she used to have this monkey. She called it a leaf monkey. I don't know if that's really the term, but they called it leaf monkeys. I guess they're tiny little, I want to say in Borneo is where it was.
Yeah.
Anyway, there's these little tiny monkeys that they have out there, and they had one as kind of a pet. And a lot of people talk about, when they talk about Bigfoot, or Sasquatch, they talk about, you know, watch out for, you know, they like females. The males like the females. And so they kind of refer to them a little bit like people, but I think we tend to forget that primates aren't far off. You know, when I'm talking about primates like apes and monkeys, they're not really that far off from us. But she had this little tiny leaf monkey. It was a female, and it had a thing for men. Like, it just loved men, especially hairy men. Like, it would climb on its arm, and it would, it's like cleaning the hairs. It's like picking the...
Grooming.
It would go in and groom the males. And she was telling me that it would do weird stuff. Like, it would copy people. Like, it would put a cigarette in its mouth, and it let a cigarette hang out of its mouth. And it did that from watching people around it smoke. But it would always put a cigarette in its mouth, and it'd walk around with it hanging out the side of its mouth.
Right.
A lot of human-type traits. And I think with Sasquatch, I think a lot of people maybe see some human-type traits. And so I think that's why we think of them as people say they're people. What I saw was an animal. It wasn't a person. But I think that's why... That's why we kind of equate, when you hear stories about different primates and different monkeys and chimps, I don't think people realize how close they are to us. And a lot of what they do is a lot of what we do. What are your thoughts?
Well, yeah, I mean, they would have to be to a very great extent, right? I mean, that's kind of the whole idea of recognizing it as a primate, especially a, you know, hominin, which is going to be the, you know, bipedal, you know, large, that bipedal primate with a relatively large brain and so on. And so there's definitely going to be behaviors that are similar. I mean, from locomotion, obviously, to, you know, the senses, the brain, the emphasis on learned behaviors, acquired behaviors, the emphasis on socialization. I mean, those are all primary things. And in the end, I mean, if you want to look at it this way, we're basically just bipedal apes also. Right, and some people want to look at it that way, and biologically, it's, you know, it's okay to look at it that way. Yeah, I mean, you would not. See, that's the thing. I mean, when I hear these stories, when I listen to a story, I always kind of an encounter. I always kind of measure it against normal primate behavior, and the strange people that want to make it something completely different and very different from humans, and it's just. It's going to look different, of course, if it's out there. It's going to look different, of course, but there's also going to be way more similarities than differences, for sure. And it's just like chimps. I mean, chimps, they're genetically, they're very, very similar. There's some very vast differences with the chimps, but there's also a lot of ways they're very similar. So, I would expect that. We're not, you know, you're not talking about a bear. You're not talking about a dog or anything like that. It should be very similar in behavior and in if it's what we can do.
And I'll have to say, it kind of reminds me, and Will, I'm probably going to want your feedback on this, because it reminds me of a lot of shows that we've had. Will, you bring up the term, what is it called, anthropomorphism?
Anthropomorphism.
Or something.
Right,
yeah,
that's people place human characteristics on non-human species.
There you go.
Well, I think it's important, too, to understand that, you know, the kind of the term anthropomorphizing, I mean, you know, the root of that term is anthropos, which basically, taxonomically, biologically means, you know, a human, but also means an ape or a monkey. So, I mean, when I think of somebody anthropomorphizing somebody as something, I think of them, you know, attributing, you know, like if you have fairy tales or folk tales or whatever, where you know, you have farm animals that are talking or having emotions or things like that that are really, really human. That's what strikes me as anthropomorphizing. I kind of look at it from a different perspective. I think it's okay to say, or it's, you know, anthropologically it's sound to say that a primate, especially an ape, a higher primate, would have behaviors very similar to ours. And you're not anthropomorphizing them, you're just describing them for what they are.
Yeah, one of the things you mentioned, Mark, that kind of stuck with me is when you were talking about in India how the monkeys go into the store and they jack stuff, you know, they'll steal different stuff and they run out of the store, they'll run out with food. And, you know, we hear so many encounters to where, like John and Sarah's place, they used to have a fish shack where their house now sits, and the Sasquatch would actually go up and steal fish out of it. They knew that's where the fish was at, and they'd break into it and steal the fish out of it. I'm wondering, some of the behaviors that we hear, the more aggressive type behaviors, to where we hear them banging on people's houses or banging on windows, standing outside of people's windows, seeing them eye to eye and growling at them. I'm wondering if there's people who are, where monkeys, chimps, apes, are the, you know, it's the animal that's around, like in India. I wonder if they have a lot of, if there's stories like that where primates come up to the place of the residence and do that type of behavior. Have you heard of anything like that?
Oh, well, sure. Yeah, absolutely. They try to scare off the occupant of the home, for example, by jumping in the window and making much of noise and throwing things around just so they can get access to the food and the resources. That's completely within the kind of suite of behaviors that those monkeys, those macaques and the other older world monkeys exhibit. You know, when they're dealing with humans, it's certainly, I mean, that's the thing about it. And that's why it's such a problem for societies over there. There's really no fear. I mean, they literally have these groups of people that it's their job to scare off the monkeys because it's just not an easy task. So there's very little fear because they're just so able to kind of outwit the humans who are trying to deal with.
Yeah, I've heard of I don't know what type of monkey it is or what type of, I think it was actually a monkey, I don't think it's a chimp, but don't they have problems with them trying to drag women off? I mean, I've read different news stories, and I don't, you know, I wanted to know your opinion on it, and I'm not really sure, and I apologize, I don't really know what type of primate that is doing this, but it's almost like they come out and try and drag someone off. Have you ever heard of stories like that?
Well, yeah, I mean, especially as it relates to aggression. And I've not heard of stories dragging them off for the purpose of holding them captive or anything like that. But it is a fact that, and Jane Goodall used to talk about this, you know, in her research in her days at Gombe with the chimps, it was herself and the female researchers that would get the most aggression from the males, especially the younger males, the juvenile or young adult males. You know, they would get the rocks thrown at them, they would get charged, they would get the vocalizations. And that was just because, you know, they were just smaller, you know, and it was pretty clear that the males knew that they were females, and they were smaller, and so they were just trying to dominate over them. So, I mean, dragging a female away I've never heard of that for the purposes of capture, but certainly it's a fact that the smaller individuals, which would usually be females and children, would get more of the aggression. There's a lot of motives for that kind of behavior among monkeys, and so it does exist. There's you know, there are different reasons for it, but whether or not it's happening here and whether or not it's you know, it's there's something doing it, that to me, you know, that would call for more. We're looking for more evidence, right? I mean, you really want to look at that at the Carter and say, okay, well, first of all, let's make sure that that's what's happening. And then from there, you jump off and say, okay, well, we can speculate about why. But is it reasonable within the context of primates generally? And the answer to that is yes, it is.
Yeah, it's interesting. You made me just think of another thing I wanted to get your take on. As far as more of the human-type behavior, going back to that leaf monkey I was telling you about in Borneo, that was a female, and it loved males, and its main, the main person who had it was actually a male, and a male human had it. It was mainly his pet, and he went to actually kiss his girlfriend, and I guess this monkey went after the girlfriend to bite her, almost kind of like a jealous, I mean, I guess as a human, I'm saying jealous. I mean, who knows what was going through its mind. But it seemed like, as she was telling me the story, it was almost kind of like a jealous, it actually went and attacked this other female. And it had this weird thing with males. It just loved males. It loved hairy males. And I was kind of curious what you thought on if you've heard that type of behavior. I guess it would be natural, wouldn't it be?
Well, absolutely it would be, because first of all, you have a couple things going on here. I mean, obviously the monkey recognized the man as being dominant, right? And monkeys, all primates are social to one degree or another, but most of them are quite social. And in order to get along in a social group, to figure out kind of where your place is and how to navigate through the group, you have to figure out who's dominant, who's submissive, and so forth. So clearly, this man was dominant. Clearly, the monkey was, by grooming and by, you know, giving, you know, kind of submitting to the man, was showing, you know, her submissiveness and her willingness and so on. But then, of course, jealousy, just like in humans, right? I mean, let's face it, you know, guys and gals, I can only speak for guys, of course, but, you know, sometimes we get jealous and we don't want it. We wish we could just switch it off, right? It's an autonomic thing, and we don't know why it's there. We try to control it. It's not helpful or good, necessarily, but it's there, right? It's kind of wired in. Same thing with all the primates, right? We are wired to try to find our mate or our partner or to make our social bond because we're competing in a social environment. So absolutely makes sense to me that that would happen. Completely makes sense. If that didn't happen, I'd be really surprised.
Yeah, because one of the things I know Sarah, she talked about, Sarah Brown, she talked about this younger male. She, you know, I think in the interview she said she feels like it has a crush on her. And I know a lot of people that were listening thought, oh, come on, really? But when she said it at the time, it really didn't strike me as odd because I've heard of these other stories like the one I just told you. And I've always thought that, well, they're not, you know, primates aren't, we're not all really that far apart when you think about it. I mean, you know, when you see things like Coco the gorilla that can do sign language, when you see different behaviors with chimps, you know, they're not, it's not really that far off. I would say they're more animal than we are, but in the overall grand scheme of things, the way they act, the way they behave is not that different. Like we're talking about the screaming. People say, well, they came face to face with the Sasquatch. They screamed and then it screamed and they both ran the opposite direction. I mean, it's kind of, you know, it kind of makes sense that being a primate, that would probably happen.
Yeah. So what we say with primates compared to humans, right? We look at the differences not being quality or qualitative differences, but being quantitative differences. For example, you know, look at chimps, right? Chimps make and they use tools, okay? So they are on kind of the tool continuum. They don't do it to the extent that we do, not even close, right? But they're there. Same thing with language. You can teach Coco sign language, but can she use verbal, you know, spoken language like we can? No. So she's on the symbolic communication continuum, but she's not as far on it as we are. So it's not so much that behaviors are different, it's just that ours are there's just more, right? It's like I used to tell my students, it was, you know, it's like a human could then, you know, you go through the drive-thru and you supersize it, right? So we'll give humans language and we'll supersize it. Give them tools, we'll supersize it. But, you know, the other primates are still getting those things. They still have those things, but just to a much lesser degree, depending on the kind of primate we're talking about.
I wanted to ask you while you were on the, I heard you mention, you know, like language and speech, and it's something we get asked periodically about the Sasquatch being able to, of course, they vocalize in a large range. As far as forming words like we do, I tell people it's not really possible because of the positioning of their head, and I can't remember from my anthropology days. It has to do with, like with gorillas, why they're not physically able to. you know, because of their head position, it sits so low in their upper bodies. And the Sasquatch is the same way. Do you know what I'm talking about? Maybe you could inform us on
yeah,
that.
Well, yeah, so, yeah, the position of the hyoid in the throat, the length of the larynx, where it all kind of is situated in order to make a full, you know, the range of sounds that we make, you know, you have to have the apparatus, the vocal apparatus for it. There's also certain areas of the brain that you have to have, Broca's area and Wernicke's area, you know, which are language centers, you know, language formation and language understanding centers, you know. So there's a big debate, for instance, among Neanderthals on whether or not they had language. I think one Neanderthal hyoid bone has been found, and it's basically the same shape as humans, so some people argue yes, but others look at the genetics and they say no. So it's very, very, very difficult to tell, and it's debated all the time. And then something, so in something like a reported Sasquatch, you would just look at, you would have to look at a physicality, you know, phenotypically, you'd say, okay, well, does it look like the throat is in the right position? You can't tell necessarily from the brain what area of language centers are there, although if it's, you know, relatively small brain compared to humans, then that would be suggestive that full language production and comprehension, the way we have it, it wouldn't be there. So, yeah, I mean, the problem is there's just so many missing pieces of the puzzle that to speculate is just really kind of difficult to do.
Right at this point. Yeah. I wish we had more to talk about with tool use, because you brought that up to me in an email once, and it's something I hadn't really thought about a whole lot, and I don't know how we'd even recognize if and what they were using for tools, but they probably do at some point.
That's the thing about tools. Tools go back 2.5 million years at least to the same time period of Australopithecus africanus, and Australopithecus africanus was basically a chimp that walked upright. I mean, it had slightly bigger brain. Its brain was about 440 cubic centimeters, and the chimp's was about 370 or so. So slightly bigger brain, but if you look at it in the face, you'd say there's a chimp. But if it walked by you down the hall, you'd say, wow, there goes a funny-looking human, right? But at the same time period, we had tools, rudimentary stone tools that were being made. So, and from there on, with the exception of a couple species, from there on, it was more tools, Homo habilis, Homo erectus, Homo ergaster, more tools, better tools, more sophisticated over time. Neanderthals had a great toolkit. So I just don't understand why, if this thing is out there, why we would rule out tools. It doesn't make any sense. I mean, even the chimps use tools for crying out loud. And the other thing is, and this is one thing I mentioned to Will, which is, it's kind of a provocative thought. But I mean, if I was out in the middle of nowhere and I found a, you know, certainly primitive stone tool, if I recognized it as a stone tool, my first thought and my only thought would be, oh wow, look, I found a primitive human tool. A human must have made it, so we're going to call it a early indigenous American tool, and we'll put it in the museum somewhere, right? So I'm instantly, just because of there's no other options, right, unless you're a Sasquatch believer or however you want to put it, my only option is to say, oh look, a human was here and got the tool. And so it would be labeled human, it would be attributed to their local Indian group probably, and no one would think anything different of it. So I'm not saying that there are tools out there, that they absolutely use tools if they're out there. I can't prove that, I can't show that, but I just think it's a very interesting notion. And I just don't see how we can rule out tool use when so many very primitive human ancestors were making pretty cool tools.
Yeah, when you first brought it up to me, it was a very interesting thought, and I had to think about it, I'm still thinking about it, you know, wondering how many times it may have come across something that was possibly done by one of these creatures, and I simply wouldn't have recognized it.
Right, and you can actually use the same kind of analogy when we're talking about remains to a more limited extent, but you can still do it. I mean, you know, if you have an upright walking, you know, hominin, a lot of those bones, a lot of those remains that you find are going to be, especially the long bones, are going to be very similar to ours, except maybe in length and size. But, you know, a lot of the smaller bones, bones of the heel, the wrist, so on and so forth. Skull would obviously be very, very different, but But anyway, I guess, for example, I mentioned earlier that I do forensic anthropology, and I often think to myself, gosh, I'm sure glad I don't do forensic anthropology in somewhere in Africa where I'm looking at an ulna, a lower arm bone, trying to figure out whether it's a baboon or a human or whatever. I mean, I certainly could do it. It wouldn't be impossible. It probably wouldn't be terribly hard. But it'd be one of those things, like here, if I see one, I'll know right immediately if it's human or not. But somewhere else, you'd have to look really a lot harder because the skeletons are so similar in primates. So same thing with the tools. You know, we're finding tools, but we're attributing to the humans naturally because that's our own choice.
I have a question, and I hate to go backwards, and I hate to, like, I'm not the sharpest tool in the shed, but, you know, we were talking a little bit, Will, you had mentioned, and Mark, I believe it is, had said something, as far as the way that the head or the larynx is formed as far as the Sasquatch being able to speak and sound like a human, but how do we justify all the people out there that say, hey, I heard it call my name, I've heard people out in the woods, I heard a baby cry, I heard a bird, and we hear all these different things about, it sounds like it can somewhat speak as a human, but now you're telling me that it's physically impossible. And I'm not trying to be an asshole. I'm just asking because I don't understand, you guys. I'm not sure, and I could be way off. But can you help me out on understanding that?
Here's kind of the dividing line there. I mean, as far as making sounds, and I know what you mean, and they do sometimes, like with the Browns recordings, and I've heard other recordings in other regions, where occasionally you'll get the impression that was a human voice making that noise. But when it comes to speech, that's a whole different thing. That's a step, you know, maybe just the next step, but it's a big step, you know, because they don't have, like Mark said, they don't have the brain capacity or maybe the physical structure to do that. But the Indians used to call, there was a term that was translated badly, I think, and I don't know what the original term was, but it translated into ventriloquist, and it's what the Indians, many Indian tribes referred to these things, and what it meant was imitator. They would imitate noises, and when it comes to, and I've heard them do numerous animal noises, and I know you guys have heard a few too.
Mm-hmm.
And we hear them people talking about them imitating what sounds like that. And like Sarah had the recording where you hear something that sounds vaguely like Sarah. It may not be that what it's doing, but to us, you know, it sounds like Sarah. You know what I mean?
I guess I do and I don't, and maybe I'm looking too deep into it, but.
I think if you can make
the sound of something that sounds like something that's saying it to you, it's, you have the ability to do it. I don't know.
So my perspective, and I mentioned this earlier, but no, from my perspective, and it's not a personal thing. I'm not discounting anything any of you have experienced or are saying by any means. Personally, I'm bound by kind of a different set of rules, which would basically say that, you know, if I hear something making a sound that sounds like an animal, I mean, why am I going to think that it is one animal mimicking another animal instead of that original animal just making the vocalization? Now, I'm not saying that doesn't happen or can't happen. I'm just saying from my perspective, and I thought I mentioned this earlier also about vocalizations.
Well, I can think of a ton of reasons. I can think, well, here's the thing, Mark, and I'm not trying to interrupt you. I can think a ton of reasons why an animal would, or another animal would be mimicking another animal.
Right. No, but right. I agree with that. But that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is,
okay,
if I hear the sound, like if I hear a wolf, right? What, you know, I there has to be a compelling reason why I think that is not a wolf, but something trying to sound like a wolf, right? And I'm not saying there's not a reason. I'm just saying, to me, the simplest answer is usually the right one, and that is you're hearing the wolf. But I mean, but if there are other reasons, if there's other evidence, you know, more power to you. But I think that part of the issue that I get into, and you know, this is just me, it's not a personal thing, but you know, it's confirmation bias, right? It's, again, the whole finding Bigfoot thing, it became a real lesson in critical thinking for my students, because basically you're going to find what you want to find. You will find a way to massage the data into what you want it to be. Some things are just going to be really difficult to explain away. They're going to be really compelling evidence. But I just think, to a certain extent, vocalizations are, it's easy to make them into what we want them to be. At least it's easier to make them into what we want them to be. But, you know, the vocalizations we heard earlier that were played, I listened to, and those sound very, very human, or certainly at least primate. So, I mean, I definitely would agree there. But I don't know. It's just kind of the way that I'm wired and the way that I'm trained that I need a little bit more, that's all.
I think what you're saying earlier with regard to, and I think a lot of people get hung up on this, and I'm by no means an expert, but in my mind, when I hear people say, like, speech, there's a difference between you, me, Will, and Mark sitting here talking and having an intelligent conversation than there is for if I hear, like, two Russian guys talking, and I think I picked out Boris as the name, and if I'm going to, from what I've heard, I say, hey, Boris, you know, I'm just kind of going off of what I heard. It doesn't mean I could sit down and have a conversation with them. But I think that's kind of what people, when they talk about the mimicking, because we've heard it so many times where, for instance, people call for their dogs at night. And then they, over time, they hear that same, almost like someone calling for the dog off in the distance, but they can't quite, it doesn't quite sound right. It sounds like a monkey trying to call for the dog, almost like it's heard it over and over again. And I think that's the difference when we talk about language and when we talk about something being, like Will was saying, a ventriloquist, something that can copy it. And if they do have that capacity to make those sounds, it's more or less making sounds. It's not that, you know, in Sarah's instance where she has it recorded like the same saying Sarah. I don't think it actually, I think maybe it's heard John call Sarah one too many times. And if they do have that ability, it's able to mimic that Sarah, you know, you know, and maybe not, but that's what I think of when.
Yeah, no.
So I think people get caught up on language and being able to mimic something that they've heard. Because even in the primate world, Mark, the primates do this monkey chatter, right?
Well, sure, yeah.
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 I was going to say that. I was going to mention that as well. Go ahead.
So different primates will chatter back and forth, right? Right, Mark? I mean, depending on what type of primate.
Yeah,
but they do that chattering back and forth.
Yes. Vocalizations are very important in the primate world, for sure. So,
and so
a good example of that would... I was just going to say a good example of that is the gelada baboon of the highlands of Ethiopia. These are, you know, they're the world's only grazing monkeys. They basically eat the grass, right? They pull, and of course they have further primate teeth, so they're not skipping the grass with their teeth. They're pulling it with their hands and putting it in their mouth, right? So they shuffle around on their butts and they pull the grass, and once they get enough grass in their hands, they put in their mouth and they chew it. But they live in massive, huge troops, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of individuals in the grasslands, the highlands of Ethiopia. But normally, baboons especially would be communicating through grooming to a very large extent. If I'm grooming you, that means I'm giving deference to you, that means I'm trying to form a bond, you're my friend, whatever. But with these gelada baboons, their hands are so busy pulling the grass that they have developed a way to, you know, or something that they call vocal grooming, which is they chatter constantly. So, I mean, if you, you know, go up on YouTube or something, I'm not sure where you could find it, but and look at, you know, look up gelada baboons and their vocalizations, and they just chatter all dang day long. And so, clearly, they're saying something that to them is meaningful, and clearly it's being interpreted meaningfully because they're doing it. If it wasn't working, they wouldn't be doing it. So I don't know how nuanced it is. I don't know if you could say there's a syntax there and a grammar and all that. I kind of doubt it. But yeah, it's definitely a chatter. It's not just a autonomic kind of grunt or a howl or a bark. It is a continuous chatter, and they're doing it all day long. So, yeah, absolutely. You know what? People talk about samurai chatter, things like that. I mean, that's completely within what, you know, what one would say is reasonable. You know, another thing about that I just want to point out about vocalization. Even though I'm saying that I'm skeptical in many instances, I'm doing it only because I myself haven't had those experiences. But one of the things that kind of keeps me interested in this topic, probably more than anything else, more than any physical evidence or anything else, just kind of makes me interested in it, is just the number of stories, right? The number of encounters, the number of normal people that are saying, wow, I you know, this is what happened. And so I'm not prepared to discount anybody else's stories if I wasn't there, you know. So I understand what you're saying, and I'm not trying to discount those experiences or those interpretations of the experiences. I'm just kind of giving you a pretty cold, you know, textbook anthropological scientific, you know, interpretation, which is not very sexy and maybe not very satisfying, but it's just kind of a baseline that we have to start from, I think.
So, Mark, let's say, for instance, you've seen Sasquatch, you've seen this 1,000-pound damn dirty ape out there running around, right? And you've seen it firsthand. So when you hear this, you might stop and go, that's possible. For a monkey chatter.
Hey, Mark, it's okay to laugh because I'm laughing. Right? I thought it was funny. It's okay to laugh, brother.
All right.
You can tell Wes he's a jerk at any time, and it won't bother me.
Well, I don't know. Maybe I'm taking this seriously, but it does make a point, though. I mean, if I saw something making that noise, I would definitely be in a different situation. No doubt about it.
Yeah, because I'm like you. The samurai chatter, and those sounds have always bothered me. I haven't been so quick to discount them. I know a lot of people discount them right off the bat, but I haven't been so quick to discount them just hearing the whole story and hearing the context behind them and knowing about the different sounds, but it bothers me to hear that. I mean, it just really bothers me to hear that for some reason. It just seems, it's kind of like I watched the Dawn of the Planet of the Apes the other day. And you know how it's almost just as disturbing to see a Bigfoot walking around on two legs as it is to watch that movie and to see these monkeys walking around on two legs. And kind of have
more disturbing.
Yeah, it's disturbing to see them up walking around like we walk around, and it's disturbing to hear kind of the language. I mean, it's real primitive among the damn dirty apes, but it's real primitive. But it's still it's just disturbing. Like the one Caesar, he tells them to go, and he screams go because the humans kind of run into each other, and you know one of them makes a yell or something, and the rest of the primates come, the rest of the monkeys come running, and then Caesar tells him to go. It's just really disturbing to see that.
The reality is, though, that the earliest, you know, bipeds were basically, like I said before, just chimps that were walking on two legs, but they looked almost exactly like it. So, yeah, I mean, so if it can happen once, you know, who's to say it can't happen again, and certainly it would be very disconcerting to see that.
Yeah, I guess I'm more comfortable seeing a monkey like in a clown suit at the circus, doing a little dance for peanuts. But when you see them up walking around and it's a little bit too much like us, for some reason it just bugs me. It just bothers me to see the same type of behaviors we have as humans. I wanted to ask you, there's two questions. One, what is in the primate world, when we're talking chimps, we're talking apes, what is the best way, do you think, to bring an animal in like that when you're out in the field? If you wanted to draw them in to you, what would be the best route to go to actually get an animal like that to come into you instead of having you go out to it?
It wouldn't be making your presence known. That's for sure, right? It would have to be some sort of food item. It would have to be something that would interest them, that they'd want to obtain, but you would have to do it in such a way that they weren't, that they didn't think they would confront you running into you. I mean, the whole idea of the disco music and the guitars and all that kind of stuff is just, it's silly.
That one always strikes me, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I mean, I hate to bring it up, but it really is silly. But, I mean, you know, again, Jane Goodall, when she first got to Gombe, she couldn't find the chimps for weeks. You know, she thought she was really discouraged. She almost went home. But it turns out they were there the whole time. They just were not making themselves known until they knew that she wasn't going to harm them or anything like that. So they probably will be very wary until they figure out that you have some sort of item that they want, like the example we gave in India and some other places. So it would have to be some item or, you know, some food item or something that would draw them in.
I wanted to ask you one last thing, and I don't know. I'm sure you know the answer to this, but in a lot of encounters, people talk about the grunting. In the primate world, let's take Sasquatch out of the picture. We're talking about apes, we're talking about chimps, different primates.
the grunting, to me, that doesn't really seem like aggressive behavior. I don't know if it's more of, when I hear encounters with Sasquatch, and I could be way off on this, but it almost kind of seems like it's an acknowledgement when it grunts, when it's grunting towards someone, or it's kind of like, hey, I'm here. In the primate world, is that when you talk about different primates, when they grunt, what type of communication, and I realize it might be different with different, within different species, but generally speaking, what is the grunting in the primate world? What type of communication is that?
The range of emotions in primates, especially the higher ones, you know, the great apes, you know, the range of emotions are huge, right? So vocalizations can have a lot of different meanings. I mean, it could be an aggressive thing. It could be just an acknowledging thing. When you live in a social group or urban, you're wired to be social, you know, you need to be able to acknowledge other people that are, or other active people that are there. But you need to be able to acknowledge other members of the group around you or people who you think might be members of the group. So it could be acknowledgement, it could be aggression, it could be, you know, it could even be submission or just communication, like I'm here. So I mean, it's really hard to say, but, you know, especially given the fact that different circumstances would elicit different vocalizations. It's really hard to
be group specific, right?
Well, absolutely, sure, absolutely could, yeah. Yeah. So the language capabilities of great apes are, you know, communication abilities are, you know, complex enough that the key with primates is the behavior is more learned than it is instinctual. So there's some hard wiring, but on top of the hard wiring is a whole kind of range of possibilities. And those, a lot of those are determined just by social group or environment or circumstances, predators, prey. So who knows? I mean, if these things are out there, they may have even developed grunts or hoots or some sort of vocalization that indicate, you know, human. That's completely within the realm of possibility, considering you have literal monkeys that do that with different predators and prey. So it's really complex, but on the same token, it's also pretty exciting because it means it has a lot of things to look at.
Well, I can't thank
you
enough
for coming
on. Well,
we really appreciate you coming on, Mark.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, well, it's my pleasure. And if you ever need anything, just let me know. I'll be happy to talk about some ideas with you.
I think you can guarantee that.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mark.
All right, well, you guys take care.
And I want to thank all our guests tonight for joining Sasquatch Chronicles. We'll see you again next week. Thanks for joining. Have a good night.